in the summer. I'm like, oh, wow. Which surprised me because when I fell a poplar in the late summer or fall, cut it off the roots and it falls, and it goes eat it on the spot, eat all the leaves off and the twigs, little twigs, but mostly leaves. And I don't cut the branches off. The next spring, it leaves out, it flowers, it starts to make fruit seed. And it's like last summer, I had one with leaves on it all summer, even in the drought, with no roots. So they have a lot of water stored. And they're called in Swedish water trees, the birches and the poplars. So.
Well, could that also be that those leaves had shadier conditions and then all of a sudden they were in?
They were sun salted.
So it wasn't necessarily like water.
But it wasn't very, because these trees have such small tops.
Okay.
So they weren't. That could be. And the other thing is, it's in a flood zone, so it wasn't that dry.
Right.
But anyway, the trees went into shock, and I didn't know if they were going to be alive, so I was very relieved when all the little twigs that didn't get broken off by the snow, because poplars are very brittle, so they break off, did leave out this spring, and they did send out their catkins, and they did their thing. But still, no new sprouts up there, only new sprouts on the ground. I'm still thinking, like the birch, that they may do it, they just may do it later. I'd be really pretty happy if some trunks stay alive, but I'm also okay to start a whole new layer of smaller pollards or poplar, which I know can work. The trouble with trees like this, if they don't sprout all over, it's disproportionate. There's a pollen guide in my files that's from New York, Spain, Basque Country. That's in English, actually, and they talk about efficiency of form. So you have your transpiration pulling the moisture from the roots up. In the Amazon, there's like negative 15 atmosphere pressure created by that in those trees. And that's, of course, what's driving your rain cycle and all that pull. But they can only pull so far if they don't have the leaves to transpire. So a shorter squatter foam is much more efficient for a shorter, smaller top. So these tops are really small for getting stuff all the way up there. They already were very small for getting up that tall trunk. The trouble was there was nothing else to cut down to because there was no growth up to here. So we did it on the chance that they'll live, and we'll see. And my dream would be that it would sprout lower down, and the next time you can cut it lower and bring it down to be more of an efficient form. So anyway, the poplars are experimental, but the maples, the oaks, the ashes are all doing fine, and I had done things like this before other spots in my land. And the yellow birches, I need more on them, and they tend to have more lower branches to begin with, because they're just very shade tolerant. And they also easily sprout and make more things, even in the shade. They just don't need as much sun for some reason. So there's the poplar sprouts. Don't they look luscious, though, if you're a ruminant feeder? And this is a nest, because most of the wood that we did is all still there, except for a few snap handles. That's that. So that's the last picture. So that's the future. I have to keep the goats out of there for a while. But we got other places to go. So questions, you've got your weird charts that I've now deciphered for you. You've got a reference list that's like not everything I've read in the last 8 years, but a lot of it got on there. And there's three or four articles about rain and trees in there, which should be evident from the titles. I didn't put my grant on there, but you can look it up on my website. There's links to the actual grant. There's also a whole page with all the pictures. So there's a place on the website that says data, a place on the grant page. Because there's like three tabs at the top of the grant page, three flower seminars page, and home page, and then a resources page. And so pick the grant one, and then there's a little line that says data, and lost charts and something else and then photo folders. Go to photo folders and there's like folders upon folders inside the folders, all very organized. You can go to other farms and you can see the cows and the sheep at the other farms eating all these wonderful samples. And that's my favorite folder. And then you can see in the trees in the demo area, there's charts about them, how we measured how long the piece was that we cut off and how high it was to that top cut, so you could add those two together and know how tall the tree was to begin with, and then how tall it was when we finished it. They're not exact. We were measuring a lot with the rope instead of like bringing up a tape measure. But they're close. And we also measured diameters of the top cut and tree rings of the top cut, like how old that growth was up there, like what age the tree was when it got to that point, basically. And those tree rings are really bad on the maples because we probably could see what the tree rings were. We're doing a lot of guessing on the tree rings. But it gives you some idea, like how old was that piece we cut off?
Would the tree rings be how old the tree was when it got to that point, or how many years it's been since it got to that point? Mm-hmm. And wouldn't it, the rings up there be like...
Right, you're right. Yeah. How many years it's been since it got to that point?
Okay.
Yeah. How old the piece is that you cut off?
Right.
Yeah, I said it wrong. Thank you.
Got a little hummingbird here.
Oh my goodness.
Stop. Is it?
Yeah, get it out before it comes to, in case
yeah.
it does.
Some of those pictures had like birch and things kind of had a lot of open sky. But if you have a tight forest already where it's like the birch goes up and it just says it's reaching for light.
We have those in here. Yeah.
Are you trying to clear back more trees to get more light? Because if you're chopping.
So we also cut a lot of fir at the get go.
To get more light in.
Opened it up a bit.
Okay.
And actually then my goats really wanted tops for this year in particular, and in the spring we only just did bark over the top of the tree. And I might have saved more of those firs and just topped them if I had done it a year later. But we did leave the ones that had branches below 10 feet of the softwoods, and we left all the cedars, which was only like 2, and we left all the hemlocks, which was only like 2. The hemlocks were already being collared by porcupines, but we collared them further. The one basswood was already collared by porcupines and I didn't touch it. And I actually have a picture with it, but I don't think it made it into this file.
So you're needing to open up the canopy more